Some of the prophetic voices in the world today are saying that 2017 is going to be a year of breakthrough for those who are positioned properly. Well, fasting and prayer can position you properly, because what Pastor Joe said was absolutely right. Fasting can put a razor's edge on our faith, and it can put us into a position where all blockages between us and heaven are gone, and God can begin to bring harvest for the seeds we've sown and bring rewards for the practices that we've done, such as prayer and fasting and giving, which we do during this time of fasting. When I called a fast as pastor, after we hadn't done it for a few years, I remember people said, "Oh, he's just trying to fit more people into the sanctuary and wants us to lose weight so we can fit more people." Can you believe that? Somebody even said, "He doesn't like fat people." Are you kidding me? I was a fat people. Dr. Ronald Cridlin, medical doctor, says fasting can save your life. And I believe that fasting coupled with prayer can give you a miracle breakthrough and fast forward your life to levels that you once may have thought were impossible. Somebody said fasting is like supernatural Drano that unblocks our supply line from heaven. Well, I really sense, and if I can be just a little bit prophetic here, I believe that this is the year God is releasing something in the church that is going to help us to walk in the same kind of power the first century church walked in. There is going to be a new outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and we're going to walk in it. So even some of you will walk by people, and they're going to be healed when your shadow hits them. I believe there's coming an unleashing of God's glory, and it's beginning right now, right here in Lansing, Michigan, and it's going to give testimonies like we have never even heard of before. God is preparing us, and the anointing that is coming, I believe that as I sat there where you're sitting, Jada, I believe I heard that God is ready to increase your anointing by 2,000-fold immediately just by the fasting you've already achieved. Now, you think fasting is a boring subject. Well, if you're positioned, you're going to get it, this increasing anointing. Now, today I want to talk to you about my discovery, what fasting is not, what fasting is, and about some of the rewards of fasting. And I really don't want to be prescriptive and say, this is what you need to do. Now, the Holy Spirit knows what you need to do. And if you have an ear tuned to heaven, which we prayed, right? He'll tell you what to do. But I do want to be descriptive and tell you some of the things that have happened in my life and Mary Jo's. By the way, there's my Mary Jo. She's so cute. Jade and Londa made one of those jib jabs of Mary Jo and me. I'm Sonny and she's Cher, and we're singing "I Got You, Babe." Ronnie Floyd, the president of the Southern Baptist Convention, I heard about him 25 years ago because he gave a testimony of what fasting did in his family. His wife Gina had a very aggressive cancer, and she was being radiated and chemoed, and she was just, it was debilitating. And when he saw that, he said, this can't go on. And this Baptist preacher down in Arkansas began to pray and began to fast for his wife. He fasted and he prayed, and here it is, I don't know, 30 years after, I learned about it 25 years ago or so, and you know how time goes, I don't know, maybe 30 years maybe, and Gina and Ronnie are still married, they have two children, even after this horrible thing hit her, and he said that fasting is the gateway to the supernatural. Fasting coupled with prayer is the gateway to the supernatural. Now, fasting is really denying ourselves from food for a certain season. For some of you, it may be one meal that you're used to eating, and then you take that time and spend in God's word and use the money you would have spent and give it to the poor so they can have a meal. For some of you, it'll be three meals. For some of you, it'll be 3 days. Some of you may be fasting all 21 days. But I know this, whatever you do, God's going to reward you in some way. You need a big reward, maybe you need to fast big, and we'll talk about that. But it's denying, and here's what David said. I denied myself with fasting, Psalm 35:15. And Jesus said, if any man will come after me, let him what? Deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. Deny himself. There's something about self-denial that we've ignored in many parts of the church. Everything is about me. I'm a king. I'm a child of God. I am royalty. But we also, that's true, but we also need to understand self-denial. And self-denial is when we take that hour in the morning to read and pray. Self-denial, but then it becomes an addiction. You can't get away from it. I mean, you can't wait to get to your holy spot, as Pastor Kev calls the secret place. And I know I'm singing to the choir when I talk about fasting. Here's what Paul said, 1 Corinthians 9:27. He said, I, like a boxer, buffet my body. Now, most Christians think he was talking about a buffet. But he said, I buffet my body, handle it roughly, discipline it by hardships, and subdue it for fear that after proclaiming to others the gospel and things pertaining to it, that he become a castaway, a counterfeit, unapproved, rejected. So Paul fasted, Jesus fasted. And what if I could show you something that has the potential of bringing revelation from God to your life? Now, if you're facing a situation and God knows the beginning from the end, he knows all the answers. This is why Pastor Kevin can say, my default position is peace. Because God has all the answers, and he's willing to share those answers with you. No matter what you're facing, there is an answer. There's a key. There's a solution. There is a miracle waiting for you, even yet today. A miracle for somebody in your family. There's a miracle waiting for you. There is a key. God has that key. He knows. And would you like revelation from God? Yes or no? Yes. Would you like quickly answered prayers? Yes. Would you like an inexhaustible supply for your needs? Yes. Would you like a rejuvenation of your health? Yes. Would you like to live a longer life? Yes. Would you like to lose some unwanted weight? Yes. That's a byproduct of fasting. How would you like to slow down the aging process? Look at me, I'm 83 and I look like I'm 66. No, I'm just messing with you. Okay. How would you like to eliminate some body toxins? Do you know the most toxic country in the world is not Bangladesh or India? It is the United States of America, with over 700,000 chemicals being put into the atmosphere and on our food. The average American now carries 10 to 20 pounds of toxins in their bodies. Now, God knew what was going to happen, and that's why he taught us about what? Fasting and prayer. People have said they've lost their food allergies, clearing of acne, skin problems have disappeared, sinus problems, blood pressure is normalized, arteries that were hardening started softening up, healthy cholesterol and homocysteine levels, mental and emotional problems cured. These are all testimonies from fasting. In fact, I remember when I called a fast, when we hadn't fasted in a while at Mount Hope, and I called for a corporate fast, and there was a lady that was a Jesus follower in our church that had never seen her 6-year-old granddaughter because years ago she and her daughter had a fight and the daughter wouldn't forgive her mother. And so then when the daughter had the baby, she would never let her mother see her granddaughter. And we went through a time of fasting, and this lady was fasting that the relationship would be mended between herself, her daughter, and that she'd be able to see her granddaughter. Something miraculous happened right here in this church. I remember giving an altar call, and this lady, this grandma, started screaming and crying, and she ran up to this altar because her daughter and granddaughter, unsaved, came to church that day and accepted Jesus. They forgave, hugged, got to meet the granddaughter for the first time. This was a reward for fasting. This was not a gift from God. It was a reward from God for fasting. I could tell you story after story after story. And this is something that can fast forward your miracle this year. It's the miracle of fasting. Now that something is the practice of fasting with added prayer. Some of you may have heard of Otto Bucklinger. Otto Bucklinger was a Christian German military officer. He was in the army, but he was serving with the Navy. But he was an army doctor, and something happened. He served in World War I. It was decorated, but something happened to Otto when he was approaching 40. He might have been 40. But he developed, back then, they called it rheumatism of the joints. Now they call it rheumatoid arthritis. And he was in constant pain. He had to leave his military post. He had to leave active duty. And he was in constant pain. They said there was no cure for it. And he didn't know what. And if you've ever met anybody with rheumatoid arthritis, they don't even like shaking their hand because just shaking hands is so painful for them. And he went to searching. And he remembered what the Bible said about fasting. That's one thing he had never done. And so he said, I'm going to fast. And if I, they said, no, you shouldn't fast. He said, if I die, I die. Isn't that what Esther said? If I die, I die. I'm going to do this. And so he went into a fast. He took only water. 19 days, only water. On the 19th day, all the pain was gone. His joints were back to normal. He could move without pain, and the rheumatoid arthritis had been cured. Now, Otto Bucklinger, what he did then was he started clinics, medical clinics, that used fasting as a first resort. And thousands of people, even mental patients, people that had schizophrenia, were coming out well enough to be in society as a normal human being, all through fasting. And he was the first doctor, first man that we know of, that ever began to categorize results of fasting. And here's what Otto Bucklinger said. He said, fasting, without a doubt, is the most effective biological method of treatment. He said, it's the operation without the surgery. It's the cure involving exudation, reattunement, redirection, loosening up, and purifying relaxation. While fasting, the patient improves his or her physical health and gains much. But then he added this. But he or she will have neglected the most important thing if the hunger for spiritual nourishment that manifests during fasting is not satisfied. And in that one paragraph, Otto Bucklinger preached my 45-minute message and called the triple benefits of fasting. He summed it up in one paragraph. So you really only had to sit in church 2 minutes instead of 45 minutes to hear that message. What I share today is descriptive. I said it's not prescriptive, but descriptive. It hasn't been reviewed or approved by the FDA. I worked at the power company. I was a follower of Jesus. I'd just recently been filled with the Holy Spirit. And I didn't really believe much in fasting. Here I was, 25, 26 years old. 26 years old, I worked my way up pretty fast. And I was working on a control board. I just sat. I was pretty sedentary. And on my way to work, I'd sometimes stop by Quality Dairy and get 12 chocolate donuts. And it did not bother me to eat all 12 the whole 8-hour shift. I'd drink coffee with 3 spoons of sugar, fake cream, you know, the kind that's made out of plastic. And I weighed 230 pounds. I'm 191 now, but I weighed 230 pounds at that time. No wonder Mary Jo never really looked at me. Well, I would go home at night, and I had this real fancy FM radio system, and I could tune in Detroit and get James Beals' broadcast called America to Your Knees. He was a pastor over at Bethesda Temple. And he had a real powerful radio broadcast. And one day he said, "I've got a brochure on fasting I'd like to send you. Write to me today, James Beal, Bethesda Temple," and whatever the address was. And so I wrote to him, and I asked for the brochure, and I got this little book on fasting. And boy, James Beal was tough. His mother was Myrtle Beal, who was in that early Latter Rain movement. And James was tough. He said, "If you as a Christian eat more than you need to keep alive, you're sinning." And there I was with my donuts and peanut butter sandwiches. Now, I know that's a little extreme, but I said, "God, I repented right then, and I planned out to go on a fast." So I fasted 3 days, no food. And then I went 90 days, no pleasant food after that, just vegetables and fruits, things that grew out of the earth. Nothing that was pleasant to me. No bread, no cake, no pie, no donuts, no sugar, no coffee. I noticed something. As I would read God's word, I began to have an understanding like I never had before. I seemed more motivated. I seemed more alive. Did I miss the food that I loved? Yeah. I wanted a steak. But I did it. Now, I needed a couple confirmations. So the first confirmation was I had suffered from allergies. And you know how you make excuses for not fasting. Well, Lord, what if I'm pre-diabetic? I probably shouldn't fast. But Lord, you know the energy I need to sit at this desk and run that control board for 8 hours. Give me a confirmation that I should fast. You know, I did it, but what led up to it was two other things. At allergies, I went to Dr. Rollinson, spirit-filled doctor from Work of Christ Community, and I said, "Yeah, I got these horrible allergies. My eyes bug out, itch, blah." He looked at me and he said, "Have you tried fasting?" I thought he'd give me a pill or something. "No, have you tried fasting?" So, okay. And then I go on out of Meyer Thrifty Acres. Back then, that's what it was called. Meyer Thrifty Acres, and there was a little book called What Women Look For in Men. And so, you know, 99 cents or 59 cents, whatever it is, a little booklet, I said, I'm going to find out because I'm 26 years old and I'm not married yet. And, you know, I come from a great Polish Czech background. They all get married when they're 17, you know. So I was just kidding back there, Mom. Not quite kidding, but, you know. And I read it, and it said the number one physical characteristic that women look for in a man is a flat stomach. I said, what? A flat stomach is the number one thing? There was my confirmation. So I did 3 days total fast. 3 days total fast, 90 days Daniel fast, and then after that, I extended it 6 months to a modified fast to where everything was measured, and I'd eat a lot of legumes, and I changed my diet. My dessert now was an apple. I still longed for those other things, but I was denying myself, taking up my cross, and following Jesus. And during that time in prayer, the Lord said, I have now advanced you by 10 years. I said, what? I have advanced you by 10 years. August, from January to August, Mary Jo came home to visit her dad who was sick. And she decided to go visit her old Bible study teacher, which is me. So she and her, I guess her brothers and a couple friends came over. There was a knock at my door. I answered the door, and there was Mary Jo home from Bible school. And I looked at her, and she looked at me and saw me, 143 pounds now. For some reason, she just fell in love. I now had a flat stomach. The number one thing she was looking for, a flat stomach. See, there are benefits to fasting that exceed other benefits. But this was a great benefit, and we've been together almost 40 years as husband and wife. 6 months later, we got married. And we still continued to fast once in a while. Pastor Snook called me and said, Dave, would you be my assistant? Sure. So I became Pastor Snook's assistant for 1 year, and 1 year and 19 months later, I found myself as pastor of this church. And I'd still go up to the altar, and I'd be fasting when nobody knew about it because I didn't want my ideas. I wanted God's plans without the stain of my logic. I found everything that God said to do, when I responded, it worked out. And I see Ed Pirate back there. He was one of our board members back at that time, and one of the best ever, by the way, Ed. You never believed it, but you were supportive, helpful. And you'll remember this. I was praying up at the altar. The Lord said, have a miracle service in December. I hadn't even been pastor 6 months yet. We had attendance of 226. When I became pastor, that went down, of course, because there were people that didn't want me. Now everybody wants me. Everybody loves me now, and if they don't, they should. But I got that from Cheryl. Anyway, Ed will remember, and some of you here will remember. If Elaine is here, you'll remember. I called a miracle service. Now, we didn't have any fancy printing. We said, well, we got to let the community know we're going to have miracles. And I called everybody to fast for 7 days. 7 days. No food. No food at all. I remember Bill Nemeth came to my office one day, because when you're fasting and you're not having food, toxins are coming out, so your breath gets bad. So during times of fasting, if somebody comes up and says, hi, you about faint. toxins are coming out. They're doing something good. Cut them a little slack. So Bill came to my office, and we were talking about some of the logistics of the meeting, and he struck noon, and he said, well, it's time for lunch, and he pulled out a little peppermint spray and went, shh, there. Oh, boy, that was good. That was our only lunch, a little peppermint spray. And we mimeographed off these postcards to send to I don't know how many miles around the church, and they were ugly, ugly. Miracle service, prepare to be healed. God wants you healed. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we ran off these postcards, put stamps on them, mailed them out, and just fasted 7 days. Had extra times of prayer. We didn't know what would happen, but Sunday morning, December 13th, 1981, there was standing room only. People were coming in to be healed and to get a miracle from God. And I remember I preached on why some are not healed. Why some people look for the wrong things in healing. And really, it's by covenant with God. And God has a key, a miracle key for you. A word for you. That's why revelation from heaven is so critical in this hour. You face things and you need a word from God. Standing room only, and I preached, and then we had everything organized. It was going to be orderly. We lined people up this way. We lined people up that way. And I remember a man that had heard about the miracle service, and I said, God, I'm just a pastor. I'm not a Catherine Kuhlman. I'm not an Oral Roberts. I'm just a pastor. But it wasn't because I was just a pastor. I was responding to what the Holy Spirit said. I was doing what God wanted done. And this guy from Kalamazoo comes, grapefruit-sized tumor, right on his side, vanished before the service was over. 8-year-old girl that had never heard her mother's voice because of deafness in the ear. The deafness opened up and she could hear her mommy and daddy for the first time in her life. And testimony after testimony. I was saying, I remember Kevin's mom. You know, she was probably younger than you are back then. She had to be, you know. I mean, she's just a young lady and beautiful and radiant and smiley. And we're just praying for people. We'd never saw this at our church before. And people started just gently going over under the power of God. And I said, this is strange. This has not happened yet. And we didn't have people catching people. They just fell. And I remember Kev's mom, Barb, was up there just beautiful, lifting her hands, worshiping God. And I remember walking up and said, in the name of Jesus, just touching her head. And she got a big grin on her face and said, bye-bye. And away she went. Those days are not over. There is a release of God's anointing that's beginning today. I really believe when we sang that, Holy Spirit, flood this place, fill the atmosphere, God filled something supernatural in this atmosphere. He answered that prayer. Something is filled in this atmosphere. The Holy Spirit did it. The question is, would that have happened if we had not fasted and prayed? There is no possible way I can answer that. But I don't believe it was a coincidence that that was the starting point of many people being healed at Mount Hope Church. We're such a toxic society. God knew about this. And Pastor Kev mentioned this last week. He said, you know, every time people fasted in the Bible, every time, people fasted in the Bible with a purpose in mind. God did something unusual and extraordinary when they did it in the right way. Even King Ahab, the most wicked man in the world. One translation said nobody was as sold out to the devil as Ahab. When Elijah said, here's God's judgment on Israel, Ahab went into sackcloth, put ashes on his head, and started repenting and fasting and crying out to God. That miserable, little, weak, demon-inspired man that everybody hated fasted and prayed, and God said to Elijah, look how he's humbled himself. I'm not going to do what I said I was going to do during his lifetime now. He held off the judgment of God through fasting and prayer. The benefits are totally off the chart for fasting and prayer. Now, Joe already told you, it's not dieting. It's not a divine weight loss program. It's not for self-punishment. It's not to be a burden on others. It's not to be an excuse for being grumpy. Do you know, and fasting will never... It's what Otto Buckinger said, that spiritual aspect is going to be the most important. It'll never get you saved. You can never go to heaven because you fast. Because fasting isn't, the rewards for fasting are not gifts. They are rewards. Always when we read, you read Matthew 6, 1 through 18, it talks about the things God rewards. And it talks about prayer, giving, fasting, getting through persecution properly. There are several things in the Bible that talks about reward. Even in Psalm 91, it says, you will give me salvation, but you will reward me with long life. Salvation and reward, two different things. Salvation is a gift. In other words, if you want to, how many want to go to heaven? Raise your hand up. How many would rather just go to hell? Be in misery for eternity. Okay, nobody wants to go to hell. But that's where everybody's bound because everybody has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. Everybody, you have. If you say, not me, I have never sinned. You are saying, God, you're a liar. Because God said every one of us have sinned and fallen short of his standard. But he said, the gift of God is eternal life by our faith in Jesus Christ. We're saved by grace through faith. Not that of our works. That's a gift. God says you can be saved by receiving my son who died on the cross and rose from the dead. Died for your sin on the cross, rose from the dead. Make him Lord of your life. Believe he was raised from the dead and I'll save you and take you to heaven. That's it. That's a gift. All you have to do is take it. A reward is something different. A reward is a perk. A lot of times when you read the word inheritance, it's reward. Now, you can be saved, but not rewarded. How about that? God loves everybody the same, but some people are rewarded differently. You see, we're not talking about salvation. So for those that say, well, fasting, you're just trying to push God's button, that's not it at all. We're trying to get ourselves into a position where God can get the reward to us. And that's what fasting coupled with prayer will do. It's like this. Everybody can work for the company, but not everybody gets the perk of riding in the limousine. All God's people are loved equally, but not all are rewarded equally. Because rewards come through our decision to practice the things that bring the rewards. And Jesus talked about it in Matthew chapter 6 and all through that. I just don't even have time to talk about all the... I mean, I wish I did. It's in my notes, but you're not getting it today. Oh, you better come back next week and you better bring somebody with you because somebody needs this next week. I'll talk to you about the rewards. And if you don't bring somebody next week, I'm going to bring my brand new BB gun. I'm not going to tell you what I'm going to do with it until you don't bring somebody next week. Really, somebody needs to hear this. Somebody you know right now is suffering and needs to hear this, and you didn't give them a ride to church today. I'm not trying to shame you. There is no shame. No shame. I'm just saying, Let's care about others. That's what the fast God has chosen. Isaiah 58, it's about caring for people. And let me tell you this too. From my heart, I want to say thank you, those of you that have stuck by Pastor Kevin these 5 years I've been gone. He is God's anointed man for this city, and when you hold up his arms, you're pleasing to God, and God's going to reward you for that. He is an honest and honorable man. He lives what he preaches and teaches. And besides, people still thanking me for... People still thanking me for you, Pastor Kev. So you better treat him good. Sure, there's going to be changes. People always talking about changes. Sure, there's going to be changes. Pastor Kev is not. Dave Williams is a scattered, disorganized, you look at Pastor Kevin's office and you look at my office and you can tell which one is mine and which one is his. And you know, there'll be little changes here and here. But you know what God is doing? What only the perceptive with revelation know what God is doing. God is laying such a deep foundation here. God is laying such a deep foundation here and building the barn so that harvest time, we're hardly going to be able to, it's like... Malachi, when God pours out a blessing, you hardly have room to receive it. There's going to be hardly room to receive the harvest. God is planning for this, and that foundation is going deep. Fasting can save your life, Dr. Ronald Cridlin said. And I don't know how I'm running out of time already, because I'll just tell you one more story. There's spiritual, mental, relational, emotional, spiritual, physical, all these kind of benefits with fasting. Whatever level you're willing to do, if you want to be rewarded. And if somebody's fasting 3 days and some great reward comes to them, don't say, I don't know why God doesn't do that to me. Well, God loves you just as much. But you didn't get the reward because you didn't do what the Bible says brings the reward. But I met, his name was Robert. They called him Andy Irons. You see, our church, and just on the physical side, our church, I remember, some of you remember Kate Harrelson. She was in her 50s. And, you know, I was just a young preacher, 30, 31, and Kate died. And she was just one of my biggest supporters, and I loved her. And I said, what killed her? Well, it was a contraindication of two different drugs. She should have been with us a great number of years. I did her funeral, cried through it. I was a very inexperienced pastor, and I really liked Kate. Now she's gone. And then over the years, another lady in Mount Hope, Sharon, had a simple infection, and they had no antibiotic to cure it because they had given her antibiotics for everything all of her life. Sore throat, cold, go to the doctor, get an antibiotic. There was no antibiotic that she wasn't immune to, and she had to die. And little Anna, in her 20s, sang in our choir every week, went to the hospital to have knee surgery, and never came out. What was it? They call it an ADR, adverse drug reaction. I came into work. Penny was our receptionist. She had been recovered from a lot of things. It was exciting. And I said, where's Penny? Oh, she died last night. What happened? It was an adverse drug reaction to an FDA-approved medicine. And I said, I'm a pastor. I am tired of these people dying. And I found out about a conference that was being held in Austin, Texas, where Dr. James Duke, who was the author of The Green Pharmacy, and Dr. Marcus Lowe, a famous ND. He was going to be an MD, but he changed to ND after he saw a few things. And are you against MDs? I'm not against MDs. I've got quotes from MDs here that are endorsing fasting. And all these people were coming together to talk about what is going on in the medical world. And I said, can I be a part of that? I got a ticket. I flew out to Austin, Texas, and I was in there. I got to meet Dr. James Duke, the famous Dr. James Duke, who wrote the book Green Pharmacy. I got to meet Marcus Lowe, which was great because I was getting his newsletters. And Marcus Lowe was going to be an MD. He was in med school. He went up to see his dad in the hospital, and there were blotches all over his dad's skin. And he looked at it, and he immediately knew that it was an adverse drug reaction. And he told the doctors, my dad is getting the wrong kind of drug. He's having an adverse drug reaction. And they told Dr. Lowe, no, this is a sign that his organs are shutting down and he's getting ready to expire. We see that in a lot of patients. And Dr. Lowe said, and Dr. Lowe wasn't a doctor yet. He said, no, that's a drug reaction. And they said, no, it's a sign that his organs are shutting down and he's going to be dying soon. And Dr. Lowe says, I'm checking him out, and undid his cords. They said, you can't do that. And he said, you watch me. And he took his dad home and took him off these drugs. Now, this is a real risk because Marcus was not a medical doctor yet. And he started giving his dad green food, spirulina and chlorella, and started having his dad walk up one step and then walk down one step, walk up a step and down a step. All the blotches cleared up on his dad's arm, and before long, his dad was able to walk around the block. And here he was sentenced to die, and through some green foods and walking, everything reversed. And that's when he changed course from MD to ND. Because at that time, now there's a lot of MDs that are just into this kind of thing. But back then, there weren't. And so he was there, and I met a young man, 18 years old, that led a presentation for his dad, Dr. Victor Irons, who had that, they call it somebody's disease. It's a two-word lady name disease where you start freezing in place and you got to get into a certain position because that's how you're going to be frozen the rest of your life. And he couldn't believe it. Six Boston doctors told him there's no cure. And he started doing some research and found the miracle of fasting. He fasted. And after a few weeks, the disease was gone, and he started discovering, this Dr. Irons, that people's colons have so much like a plastic substance. That's why they don't absorb nutrients anymore. And this kid, his son, I mean, Dr. Irons was 98 years old, and here's his son, 18 years old. Dr. Irons fathered him when he was 80 years old. And this kid was showing us pictures of what was happening at the clinic, things that were coming out of people when they would fast. And some of it looked like hefty trash bags. And he explained, that's the coating from our childhood, teenage years, the things we've eaten coated our colon. Remember, this is descriptive. Some of the stuff looked like ropes with knots in it. And so I made the mistake of telling the congregation about that seminar, that workshop I went to at the big health conference. People started calling me, telling me about their bowel movements. Believe me, I didn't say send me pictures. So this man, 40 years old, diagnosed with that disease where you freeze up, and I forget the name of it, where you just freeze in place. And he was healed through fasting. And so he was telling other people about this. And in 1950s, guess what? He was arrested. They said, "You are selling drugs that have not been approved by the FDA." He wasn't selling drugs. He was selling psyllium seed and green drink. And they said, "If you recant and never teach this again, we'll drop the charges." And he said, "All the people that are being helped by this, if you take it away from them, you're going to burn in hell." That's what he said. So he went to jail. 6 months, he got a six-year sentence. 6 months he was out and founded the National Health Organization. Served on there till he was 98 years old. Can you imagine this? Death sentence at 40 and living to be 98. And you know what killed him? A car accident. But it was amazing to see how toxic our bodies become. So our bodies get a benefit. Our emotions get a benefit. But as Dr. Buckinger said, the greatest benefit is the spiritual benefit, because we have a closer fellowship with the Father, and we begin hearing things that are on the Father's heart. He begins to declutter our lives and help us focus on what's important, and the key word that's going to give us a fast-forward miracle for this year. Amen. Father, I thank you for the time you've given us here together, and I pray that the Holy Spirit has used me in some way to motivate and inspire believers to want the perks that come only to those who pray, fast, give, and get through persecution properly. Lord, all of us are facing something, and I pray that what was released in the atmosphere as the worship leaders sang, this flood of the Holy Spirit that released miracles into the atmosphere, right now, in Jesus' name, as a reward for those of us who have fasted, I ask you to release your healing love at this moment. Turn around every situation that is unlike you and unlike heaven. And thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I come against everything that has come against you, my brother, my sister, that is unlike God, and everything that the devil has meant for your evil. God, right now, puts it on a rewind, reschedules it, and puts your life on fast forward once again. While our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, nobody's looking around, how many here know beyond any question you remember the time in your life that you were born again? Fasting is great, but you must be born again to see the kingdom. You're here today, and you're sure everything is well with your soul. As we sang that today, it is well with my soul. You're going to heaven, and you know what? Slip your hand way up high. Thank you. You may put them down. How many here would say, "Dave Williams, I'm not sure if my heart were to quit beating, or Jesus were to come, I'm not sure I'm ready to meet him. But I would like to pray a miracle prayer with you, and I know how to pray that miracle prayer with you. It'll only take 15 seconds because I guess I'm out of time." You're here and you'd say, "Dave, would you pray that everything be okay between God and me, that I have a home in heaven?" Slip your hand way up high. All across, thank you, thank you. How many others with an upraised hand? Over here, thank you. How many others with an upraised hand? Back here, back there. How many others would say, "Dave, pray for me. I want to be sure I have a home in heaven." Now listen, let's all stand to our feet for just a moment. Well, no, for the rest of the service. I saw hands go up. I want everybody take the hand of the person next to you in your row. If you raised your hand, make sure you squeeze the hand of the person next to you so they know that you're one of those. We're going to pray a prayer with you. and then we have to release you because of the 11:30 service. But pray this, say, dear Lord Jesus, I believe you died on the cross, and I believe you were raised from the dead. Forgive my sins. Come into my life. Be my Lord. Give me a home in heaven when I leave this life. I believe you were raised from the dead, and I declare you as my Lord from this day forward. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Now, if you prayed that prayer, that simple prayer, Pastor Kev has written a book about your journey with God. He'll give you a free copy. How many here are going to fast? Raise your hand way up high. How many are going to continue fasting? Raise your hand way up high. I pray the Lord bless you and keep you. I pray the Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. I pray the Lord heal you where you hurt today in the name of Jesus our Lord. And I pray that you'll keep him enthroned as Lord all the days of your life. I pray it as a blessing. I speak it. I decree it. In Jesus' name, amen.